Okay, so I don't know. No, of course I know. So to start with, before we kind of drift off into those boring questions and so on, so we have to first tackle on the actual the important question. So it's not even weather, but how much did you like our book?
Give the numbers.
That's a wonderful question. I have it here, and I was just looking at it, and while I was preparing to talk to you guys, well, of course there's no numbers that can tell how much I like the book. All these wonderful images are available for viewing and studying, and also the names of these photographers are. In a way, being made well known, because maybe only if you are really an expert or very interested in photography history, maybe you have heard one or two of these names. And now it's great that they are all available in the book. And I also think that was unexpected, and I think very promising that. Latvian and Estonian photographers are discussed side by side. I don't think that happens very often, and it's interesting that we have this idea that the Baltic countries, we are like these strong identities, three Baltic brothers or sisters, but at the same time, in terms of everyday daily life, how we produce our culture and how exhibitions are organized and how we write our history, I think there is not so many cases when we actually view our respective art histories side by side. And this was for me a very surprising in a very positive way, and I think it's a very promising way how to look at the history of art and especially photography. I think I'm very happy with the with this the historical part about all the about the way how we get this introduction to different different lives and careers of these women photographers, and the way how the images are laid out and designed. But also there is a couple of things that I was thinking that I would probably expected a little bit more clear, critical discussion about the problem that kind of is in the background about the women photographers and their careers and why their lives are forgotten. It's mentioned there, but probably I would have liked maybe a little bit more kind of theoretical debate about it, and maybe contextualizing a little bit more in the within the history of the region in general. But that's just from my academic perspective, I just always would always look for more theoretical discussion. But otherwise, that's just for the future research.
There is also partly in the background somewhere a difference in how we with Shelda both or each of us approached the material. When Shelda very fluently goes into the woman history discourse of it, then I was on the contrary pushing it towards a more general approach to the lost and the forgotten heritage as such, where the woman history is just a very good example of it. But now misusing your thorough academic background, so I can with you discuss it a little bit. Now, when we take this broader context of the woman history, it definitely has its very strong political undercurrents and so on. But how would you, or how important, or how justified is my you know, interest in trying to misuse it in order to showcase the importance of the lost and forgotten. Am I in some way doing injustice to the woman history writing discourse when I want to push it in that direction? Because in Estonia we have had recently quite a few museum shows which are dedicated to the lost and forgotten heritage, you know, like all the burned paintings and never built houses. So can we put woman history also in this lost and forgotten, and then the you know, I even managed to say to Evita Kosa in an interview that the Silver Girls was all about finding new stars, so we need just new authors.
Yeah, I think there is a lot of complex issues at work, and there is no one single answer or one single way how to look at these particular photographers or at the historical material, and there is multiple layers, and because, for example, the main problem I think is that the history of photography itself is a very forgotten or never important enough field. So it's the medium itself is already somehow not really forgotten, but not really paid much attention to. So that's one thing that you have to deal with, that photography itself is valued, and it's you give attention and you give importance to photographers, and by studying their lives and showing their work. So that's just larger context. And then of course the history of women photographers, which definitely is related to the general gender theories and how we need somewhat feminist insight into this, because we can't otherwise just pretend that it doesn't exist nowadays. And also in general, how history of our region of Latvia and Estonia in particular, how these histories themselves have been in a way stretched in whichever direction according to different times. Like, it's just the same as we know that how the main streets in many cities were renamed, like depending on what is the government. Is it like Russian Empire, or is it Soviet Union, or is it German occupation, or is it a free republic? So also with every historical turn, also our histories have been rewritten according to the whatever the choices were of the powers to be, and that also somehow translates to art, maybe in a lesser way, but still, and visual culture in general, and also has influenced how we view photography, or rather how we still oftentimes tend to overlook photography or not pay enough attention. And of course, that's not only a problem of our region, but it's I think in our region it's more interesting, because there have been these during the 20th century there have been these radical changes when histories have been rewritten. So which how do we even begin to unravel all that, and how do we begin to look at what has been forgotten? We can ask at what time, at which historical period was forgotten, why, for which reasons, and so on and so forth. So there is, I think, a lot of complex issues at work that can be further examined and used for future projects and shows. I don't know if that answers to your question, but that's what I was thinking when about.
But when we look at the heritage of our photographers, you know, in this kind of the bigger world photography history context, and again misusing the situation that you with your several years in the United States, where you definitely much more researched than international photography history, I cannot pose a question whether our history has any importance. That isn't really a clever question. But how typical is the material that we have? How much can we talk about like local particularities of the setting? Because with Plavinia, one can even feel that it looks like she has been looking at some magazines and that she is in a way trying to copy some similar compositions and so on. And so how similar is our heritage to the international, like, yeah, in the context of the international?
That's a very good question, and also there is no one single answer, but there is a lot of complex things to take into account when thinking about that, because yes, it is true that that is also one of my deep beliefs, that history of photography as we know it, most of the big textbooks, big history books, they all are written from a very narrow perspective of mostly US, French, German approach. So there is this I have reviewed and analyzed most of these big textbooks that say history of photography of 20th century, world history of photography, international global history of photography. There is not so many of them, but there is you definitely have at least some of them at home. And when you start analyzing what does it mean, international or global, especially those books, it simply means the same American, German, and French dominated history. But then there is at the end attached a chapter on, let's say, Japanese photography or something else, like maybe 15 pages or maybe somewhere in the middle, something like that. So in general, we don't have yet truly global history of photography. In art, in broader field of art history, there is more, because it's just a bigger field, there is more research and there is more developed theoretical approaches. So there is really attempt to write a global history of, let's say, modern art, or a global history of 20th century art, which is not really focused on this perspective of what happened in New York, what happened in Paris, and what happened in Berlin, which is the basis of all 99% of all the histories of photography. So far, I think until very recently, the history of photography, this field as a field, has been dominated by this approach that I call the MoMA approach, the Museum of Modern Art in New York approach, which is like the most influential institutions in the world that somehow sets the tone how we should look at many things in. How we should view different art movements and how we should interpret specific artists or artworks. And in terms of photography, their approach has always been to look for the so-called modernist photography. So to look for something that looks like those modernist works that they already have, that looks something like, maybe, I don't know, Russian avant-garde, looks a little bit like the American photographers of the 1920s or 30s or later, that looks like Life magazine photographers, something that looks like Cartier-Bresson, something that looks like whatever there is already in this canonical list of US, French, and Germany-based histories of photography. And my deep belief is that this is a time when we have to really put this perspective aside and not compare our local histories with this mainstream with this mainstream of this modernist school, because that will lead us nowhere, because that's not a fair comparison. There is different, there is specific cultural and social and economic circumstances in these larger metropolis kind of cities like New York or Paris. Of course, they are important centers. There is no doubt about it. And the avant-garde movements happened there. That is also true. We're not going to try to say that it didn't happen. But I think what we have to say is that it's not the whole story of art and of visual culture to focus only on this avant-garde or only on this innovation, because there are other regions, other cities, other countries had different social, political, and cultural environments and contexts, and different ideas were important to them. And let's say if you didn't live in Paris, you didn't become a surrealist. That's just normal. That doesn't mean that you are less valuable. Your work needs to be discussed in the in how important it is locally and how important it how importantly or how well it reflects something that was important locally. And I think that's the answer. Where is the value in all these works? We don't have to think about, do they look interesting from a perspective of Paris avant-garde movement, but we have to see, oh, but they reflect this unique thing that we have here, and this is the only person who has captured that, and here it is, and it is a value. And I think we need to be very clear with this historians, the curators, theoreticians who work from these small kind of seemingly insignificant areas. I think we should always keep in mind that it's not insignificant because it is the unique reflection of what is the specificity of this particular region. And that is what we need to highlight, and that is what we need to continue promoting, instead of saying, oh, but we also have some kind of small surrealist collection or something, if you.
In this context, from one local curator, I heard a very funny kind of comment about the exhibition that was before the book came out. Which is, you know, you sometimes get those compliments which are sort of compliments and criticism at the same time, but not obligatory criticism towards you, but towards the works that are exhibited. So this is what I got from this person, was that it's a really great exhibition, I really liked it, but you know, those photos, you know, kind of, you understand why why we did not know them, or something like that. They are not that strong, or something like that. Was like, and you kind of are left with this this interesting moment, which I have been also talking lately a lot about, and hopefully in the future also in the written form more. About this obsession with some kind of canon, that there is those, you know, the best of the best image from that time of the how the landscape should look, or that and this, and what makes the value of the image. Because I actually we both have heard a lot of compliments of not going that direction, actually, in the exhibition, that we did not choose obligatory always the works that for that time would be considered their best work, because we actually excluded from many authors the works that would be considered from different aspects the best, the example of their capabilities, both creative both creative and technical, and etc. And instead going for something that would be more interesting as a story or as an interesting aspect, both to that person and both in general in that exhibition, as the story that we want to glue together, you know, from all the authors. But
Yeah, no, absolutely. I absolutely understand what you're saying, and that what you're saying fits into this new wave of art history that I tried to describe. And that's just maybe, of course, there's going to be people who are going to say, oh, yeah, but these works, are they really so great? And that will require maybe a whole generation to really change the understanding of that understanding of visual culture and photography, which is based on different values than just looking for these great, unique, innovative, avant-garde artists, that that something that is different from this MoMA approach, that they have these researchers that travel all over the world and they do this local research. Okay, we found this five avant-garde artists in Poland, and then we found three avant-garde artists here in Brazil, and we kind of bring it all together and show this great canonical vocabulary of modernist art, let's say. That I think it's the case of just explaining your methods, explaining your approach, and just discussing about it and telling over and over again what is that, what are these things that we are looking for in these photographs and why we present them to you. And I think that's one thing is that we can do, just try to explain and explain over again.
In this context, I remembered also the experience through the project working with and communicating with different researchers of photography. And there was kind of two typical reactions. One was very enthusiastic and happy that somebody kind of mm-hmm. takes it up and they try to help mm-hmm. as much as possible. And then there were others that had this kind of attitude that, first of all, that this is a fashion now, and that mm-hmm. that this shouldn't be the reason why to do it, that it's, you know, just because it's fashionable now to do this kind of research mm-hmm. and exhibitions, because the feminism has a moment again, and secondly, that there isn't any great works there or something like that, so why would we kind of go direction where you can't find those, yeah, those iconic works or something like that. But in this still kind of comparison topic, I wanted to also ask, one thing is the topic itself and how it showed, but the other is, you have been living for quite some time in New York and have seen most probably a lot of exhibitions that also are looking into the history in different, talking, you know, about the history in different ways, or decide on different strategies how to then tell the story about the history. And I remember till this day clearly how we were talking with Alexei Murashko about how I really, really don't want to exhibit printed out pictures on the walls and something like that, and I wanted somehow to, that the way how they're exhibited, it immediately tells the story also as well. Mm-hmm. So just, you know, if you would compare the show that we made to something that, how to the strategies that are, for example, curators, I don't know, in New York or somewhere mm-hmm. else, making, what would be your comment on that?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. First of all, I have to say that most larger photography exhibitions that I have seen in New York and traveling somewhere else mostly are very, how to say, old school and very traditional, because the history of photography is still this relatively marginalized field within broader, how it is seen within the broader art field of art and art history. So most of them are in the terms of design and exhibition organizing, they are kind of mostly rather disappointing, and that of course is also the probably one of the reasons why is that so, because that's the expectations of the audience, because people still most people would expect that the photography exhibitions will be displayed in certain way, meaning traditional, especially about history, when it's like early photography, it's kind of very traditional expectations. So the institutions, the museums, for example, they also don't want to risk and kind of offer two radical innovations. And in that sense, I think that's also a very how to say, it's a benefit to work in places like Tartu Museum, where you can fully realize your ideas. In terms, the only limits are the material, like whatever expenses and so, but at least you can pursue your vision. And I think that's not very often to be seen in photography exhibitions. And just one good example that I think is just worthwhile to mention that I have seen and really thought, that's finally something good, is that so there is this the same, we have to return to the MoMA, to the Museum of Modern Art, which is like this trendsetter in art, in art history, in exhibition design. And their permanent display is always a big topic to discuss, because they have this tremendous collection of all these modernist, all the main important modernist artworks. And so they have this story that goes from the early 20th century up to contemporary art, and they rearrange this exhibition from time to time. And the last rearrangement happened last year, and then that was also the last before probably closing down for COVID later. So and the last rearrangement was in for many people it was really shocking, because for the first time in this permanent display, when 20th century began, they put together with paintings and sculptures, they also put photography and video. And that seems like such a simple thing, right? It takes place at the same time. There is important developments in film and photography at the same time. For example, when Picasso works and makes his cubist works, and so on. Historians even have discussed how, for example, Picasso was influenced from photography and film, and especially with this gray tonality, because he was influenced from the black and white film and photography, and so. But now people had to wait until 2019 to finally see all these things exhibited together side by side. So I think that's just a sign that probably there's going to be a more inclusive approach to photography also in the future, in more also in internationally, because I think it just shows a good example, and I have good hopes about it.
You know, what other quad ways would we have to tell the story? You know, because when you criticize this MoMA approach, then for example, making the photography history into an art exhibition actually is a way how to get out of this. You know, we could totally imagine that you that they are Estonians and Latvians doesn't really matter in the framework that we made for the exhibition. So, can you help us in developing some further directions? What else could be done to the material that wouldn't be this national photography history?
Yeah, I think there is a lot of different ways that different directions that you could take. I was just thinking one way that comes to my mind. Of course, I think there is many different and very perspective ways to go. But one would be to go a little bit in depth into the biographies and careers of these women photographers, and trying to inscribe them more into the existing histories, into the histories of visual culture, and not necessarily art, but also art. But most of them had never from what I understand, most of them never were really artists or never had this career as artists. Mm-hmm. So that may be not so much into field of art, but more in the in general, in visual culture, and of course in the general history. And by doing so, of course, emphasize this gender aspect of how histories have been written and use these examples as a way to offer or to rewrite one little fragment of history of this region. And that would be, I think, that's one perspective way. So we start with the very specific life and biography and career of one woman, and we have these works, and we have the some information that we have, and then kind of critically examine how this fits into what we know about that the time period, and why I think it's going to be probably difficult to inscribe them in this historical pattern, because and that is also part of the work, because it will show you where these where we our cultural heritage or where our histories are lacking, where there is not enough there is not enough background. So you will find yourself that there is that these examples will reveal larger broader problems in the history. So that's one way how to think about, I think, about future research, to focus more on these different aspects about what is known about these women, about their class, because there was very different class backgrounds, their economic situation, ethnicity, also all these professional contexts, and kind of that would help say something new and meaningful about history itself, to reveal unknown chapters of the history, and also to show how this history writing so far has been only one-sided and allowed for these women to be completely forgotten.
Yeah, so we would in a way bring them to the real life from the fairy tale.
Yeah, from the reflection in the mirror.
Yeah.
Well, now you can saying when you bring them to real life, I just imagine now you can make a full length movie about them.
Yeah, that's with some. There are even some characters that would, I mean, Merguppe with her history and Lydia Tarem, and they would deserve a movie of their own, actually. Yeah.
Yeah.
So next stop, documentary.